Hello everyone, and welcome to some more remote learning. Today we're going to go further into the Taylor series, but more specifically, how to use the Taylor series with limits. Now we've already done a lot of work with power series, such as combining, differentiating, integrating, finding that relationship. And because Taylor series is a power series, those same kinds of rules and methods apply. So differentiating, integrating, it's going to be very similar because Taylor series our power series. But one thing we really haven't touched on is how to use Taylor series to help us evaluate difficult limits. For example, limits that require multiple iterations of L'Hopital's rule, or limits that are just really hard to figure out how exactly to simplify them down. Taylor series are going to be super helpful in actually solving those out. So let's go ahead and jump into a couple of these problems. So for example one, part A, that should read A, not B. I'll fix that when I post the worksheet. We're going to be taking the limit of the sine of x minus x over x cubed as x approaches 0. Now, think about plugging in 0. The sine of 0 is 0, minus 0 is 0, so we have 0 over x cubed, which 0 cubed is 0. So this is a good case for L'Hopital's rule. But now that we know how to represent functions using Taylor polynomials, there's no need to use L'Hopital's rule. So this is where you can look at the table of your common Taylor series functions that are centered at 0. So for sine of x, we've done this in a previous example problem, so you should be familiar with that sine of x. But as opposed to writing it in sigma notation, I'm going to actually write out the first couple of terms. So the sine of x, that Taylor series, starts with, and let me go ahead and rewrite my limit as x approaches 0. We have x, that's the first term in that Taylor series, and then we have x cubed over 3 factorial, and that's subtracted, that's the second term. And then we're going to add, the third term is x to the fifth over 5 factorial, and then that next term would be x to the 7th over 7 factorial, and so on. That is the sine of x represented as a Taylor series. And then you can see that we're subtracting x from all of this, so just rewriting the rest of my numerator, and that's all divided by x cubed. Now it's as simple as algebra. All we have to do is solve. So this x right here is positive, whereas we're subtracting that x. So x minus x cancels out. So let's simplify this limit down a little bit more. We'll have the limit as x approaches 0 of, I'll go ahead and rewrite that numerator, but putting my denominator within those denominators of my fractions. So I have minus x cubed over 3 factorial times x cubed plus x to the fifth over 5 factorial times x cubed minus x to the 7th over 7 factorial times x cubed, and so on. So if you notice now, my x cubed cancels out with x cubed. This x cubed in my denominator will get canceled out, and that exponent of 5 goes to 2. This x cubed gets canceled out. That 7 goes to 4. And you can envision having more terms, that next exponent, that x cubed would get canceled out, and that numerator would go to 6, and so on. I no longer have x's in my denominators, I only have them in the numerator. So if I'm taking the limit of this, as x approaches 0, all I'm going to have left is this very first chunk. Because x squared goes to 0, x to the 4th goes to 0, x to the 6th, x to the 8th, and so on. All of those terms will go to 0, and 0 divided by 5 factorial, 0 divided by 7 factorial, by 9 factorial, will all go to 0. So all I have left is that first term, which will be a negative 1 over 3 factorial, and we all know that 3 factorial is 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6. So the limit in example 1, part A, is negative 1/6. And let me scroll over so you can see that negative 1/6. And that's it. That's how we use Taylor series to figure out the limits. We take that series, not necessarily that sigma notation, but the first few terms in our series enough to get an idea of the pattern. So let's try B. And again, I'll fix this lettering when I get this worksheet out for you guys. So now for B, we have the limit as x approaches 0 of x squared over 2 minus 1 plus the cosine of all over x to the 4th. Note, plugging in a 0, we'll get 0 minus 1 plus 1, because the cosine of 0 is 1. So that's 0 minus 1 plus 1, which is 0, all over x to the 4th, which is 0. Again, this would be a good case for L'Hopital's rule, except we'd have to do it a couple of times. So what function can we use a Taylor series for? This one right here, that cosine of x. And remember, the cosine of x is similar to the sine of x, except as opposed to having those odd exponents, I'm gonna have my even exponents. So I'll have 1 minus x squared over 2 factorial plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial minus x to the 6th over 6 factorial, and so on. So again, feel free to reference your table where you have those common Taylor polynomials. But let's go ahead and actually plug that in into our limit, simplify down, and see if we get our limit. So this is going to be limit as x approaches 0 of x squared over 2 minus 1 plus, make sure you keep those parentheses in there, we're going to have 1 minus x squared over 2 factorial plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial minus x to the 6th over 6 factorial. And I like to do a couple extra terms just to make sure I can pick up on that pattern. So that'll be plus an x to the 8th over 8 factorial, and so on. Feel free to write out more if you think it's necessary for you to pick up the pattern. And that is all over x to the 4th. So you can see that when simplifying this down, I have a negative 1 and a positive 1, so those will go to 0. Then you can see that I have a positive x squared over 2 and a negative x squared over 2, because 2 factorial is 2, so those will cancel out to equal 0, to leave me with x to the 4th over 4 factorial minus x to the 6th over 6 factorial plus x to the 8th over 8 factorial, and so on, all over 4 factorial. So what I'll do is I'll go ahead and distribute that x to the 4th into each of those denominators so I can simplify down. So this would be the limit as x approaches 0 of, we'll have x to the 4th over 4 factorial times x to the 4th minus x to the 6th over 6 factorial times x to the 4th plus x to the 8th over 8 factorial times x to the 4th, and that continues on. Note, just like what happened above, we're going to get some things to cancel out. So x to the 4th cancels out with x to the 4th in my first term. X to the 6th over x to the 4th, that entire x to the 4th cancels out, and this x to the 6th goes to an x squared. Then my x to the 8th over x to the 4th, that x to the 4th gets completely canceled out, and my x to the 8th goes to an x to the 4th, because 8 minus 4 is 4. So think about now, if I take this limit as x approaches 0, well, in my first term, I don't have an x at all. And in the following terms and everything to follow that, I'm going to have x's in my numerators alone, which means all of those terms will go to 0 as x approaches 0. So what I have left is positive 1 over 4 factorial, which 4 factorial is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, which is 1 over 24. So the limit in this second part of our example is 1/24. So if you want my opinion, I think it's a little bit easier to use Taylor series as opposed to doing L'Hopital's rule a lot of times, or sometimes it's going to be very, very difficult to do. Taylor series is the way to go. And let's do one more practice example, because the methodology behind these is all fairly similar. It's just a matter of substituting in those Taylor series and the first few terms of those Taylor series, and then algebra from there. So in this one, we are going to evaluate the limit as x approaches 0 of x squared e to the x times cosine of x minus 1. Note, plugging in 0 will get us 0 in our numerator, and 1 minus 1 will be 0 in our denominator. 0 over 0 would be a case of L'Hopital's rule, although we're going to evaluate this using Taylor series. And here I have two functions where I can plug in Taylor series, e to the x and the cosine of x. So reference that table of common Taylor series and plug those in. So we're going to have the limit as x approaches 0 of x squared times the first few terms of e to the x are 1 plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the fourth over 4 factorial, and so on. That is e to the x, that Taylor series representation, writing out those first terms. And for cosine, we've used that up above, so rewriting it, that's going to be 1 minus x squared over 2 factorial plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial minus x to the 6th over 6 factorial, and continuing on. And that's all subtracted by 1, just finishing out that denominator. So right away, looking at my denominator still, 1 cancels out with this negative 1. So that goes to 0. Now what I'm going to do here, as opposed to distributing this x squared in, I'm going to rewrite my x squared, and I'm going to want to put it in my denominator as a 1 over x squared. So if I took this x squared and wrote it as multiplying my entire denominator by 1 over x squared, remember, dividing by a fraction is the same as multiplying by its reciprocal. So I did not change the value of this series at all. But this will allow me to rewrite it, trying out a different pattern. So we have the limit as x approaches 0 of our numerator is just going to be 1 plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial, and so on. And my denominator now, distributing that x squared in, will be negative x squared over 2 factorial times x squared plus x to the 4th over 4 factorial times x squared minus x to the 6th over 6 factorial times x squared, and so on. You can see that my x squared cancels out. My x squared cancels out here and here, leaving me with not x to the 4th, but an x squared in that second fraction, and not an x to the 6th, but an x to the 4th. Now remember what our end goal is. Our end goal is to not have 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity. We want to be able to evaluate this limit, which now we can, because our denominator will no longer give us a 0, because we have a term that does not contain x, and x is in the numerators of all of the other terms within that denominator, so those will all go to 0 as x approaches 0. So finally, plugging in 0, let's go ahead and highlight everything that goes away, just so that you're clear. This x goes to 0, this x squared over 2 will go to 0, x cubed over 3 factorial will go to 0, x to the 4th over 4 factorial will go to 0, so all we have in our numerator is 1, and then in our denominator, I already circled the term that we have left because that x squared completely canceled out, but just so you can see, plugging in 0, x squared over 4 factorial cancels out, x to the 4th over 6 factorial cancels out, and all of the other terms following that will have x to some even power over some factorial that will all cancel out. So what I'm left with in this problem is going to be 1 from my numerator over a negative 1 over 2 factorial in my denominator. And we know that 2 factorial is just 2. So 1 over negative 1 half, flipping that fraction, that becomes a negative 2. So negative 2 is my limit for this practice problem. I understand that maybe you wouldn't see to move that x squared down into the denominator, and that's okay. But remember, the end goal is to actually be able to evaluate this limit and I still had a zero in my denominator, which is definitely stopping me from evaluating the limit. Zero in my numerator would be A-okay, as long as I also didn't have zero in my denominator. So that's when I saw that I had an x squared, and then powers greater than x squared. That's when I knew to move my x squared down so that I can have some term and the rest go to zeros. So these take practice. So feel free to grab more examples from your book, ask me questions in the comments below, and watch those lesson videos. But hopefully you learned something and got some extra practice from the examples I did complete. But until next time, good luck.